Carry the one. 170 billion euros. So that's the budget of the European Union this year. But who handles this money? And what is it used for? And where does it come from? It's time to talk about wasting money.
Welcome to Catch the Eye Politics, where we explain how European politics work in practice. I'm your host, Jimmy. In this video, we'll look at whether the EU is a waste of money and how much it costs in the first place. Obviously, there are many different ways of looking at this question. Five, in our case.
Let's start with question one. Is EU money spent on things member states don't want?
To answer this question, we should look at who decides how EU money is spent.
There are actually two answers to this question, because the EU uses two types of balance sheets, annual budgets and long-term budgets. Similar to many other things in the EU, annual budgets are first drafted and proposed by the European Commission, and then changed and finalized by national governments and the European Parliament. But an annual budget is really just a more detailed breakdown of something that has long been agreed in principle, under a long-term budget. So let's focus on that.
Exactly because they're so decisive, long-term budgets work a little differently.
First, the European Commission talks to everyone and prepares an initial draft. Then, it's up to the member states to sort out their inevitable disagreements in the Council of the EU and in the European Council. These negotiations are tricky, not just because everyone wants a say on how to split the pie. Governments also have to agree on how big the pie should get. Money doesn't grow on trees, and the EU's own income is pretty limited. Already, around 70% of the EU's budget comes from the member states. To be able to spend more money, the EU would either need to collect new own resources or raise national contributions. Long-term budgets need approval from all EU member states, so negotiations can drag on for years and include lots of haggling and horse trading.
I want no quid pro quo!
This is tedious, but it also means that no one gets to complain, because every single country explicitly agreed to it. Even you, Netherlands, Austria, Denmark, and Sweden.
Once that's done, the European Parliament finally gets a vote. But it can only say yes or no to the whole thing, not move around any money or make any changes. In practice, this means that MEPs only have very limited influence on the final outcome and are essentially forced to accept what the Council came up with.
I mean, what else are they going to do? Rejecting a long-term budget means scrapping years worth of negotiations without any guarantee that the replacement will be any better. And in the meantime, EU spending would just continue from month to month, making any forward-looking planning and investing almost impossible. In other words, it's not worth the trouble.
To answer our initial question, EU money is indeed only spent on things that member states want to spend it on. There will always be expenses that are more important to one country than another. But that's in the nature of a compromise between so many governments. And if leaders weren't happy with EU spending, they wouldn't have done what they did in 2020. They created a whole new pot of money next to the long-term budget, a pandemic recovery program worth 800 billion euros. And for the first time in the history of the EU, most of the money for this will come not from taxes, not from national contributions, but from EU borrowing on the capital markets.
This was completely unthinkable before the pandemic, but national leaders agreed that it would be a good idea to take on common debt to finance the post-pandemic recovery.
But anyone who's ever shopped at IKEA knows that just because you want something doesn't mean you need it. Which brings us to question two. Is EU money spent on things member states don't need?
To find out, we just have to go through the seven headings of the current seven-year budget. But let's do it quickly.
Heading one includes investments in research and innovation, important infrastructure, and programs to make sure that the EU market functions as it should, with healthy competition and strong consumer protection. Oh, and the European Space Program. Heading 2 is the biggest one, and houses investments in underdeveloped and poorer regions of the EU, disaster and pandemic response, and programs for reskilling and youth employment. Oh, and Erasmus Plus, of course. Heading 3 is another big one, and includes lots of spending on agriculture and fishing, plus a bit of money for environmental protection and transitioning away from dirty fossil fuels. Heading 4 is relatively small and does exactly what it says on the tin. Just like Heading 5, Security and Defense. Heading 6 is all about international development cooperation, humanitarian aid, and support for countries that may or may not join the EU soon.
All in all, the EU will spend about 2 trillion euros between 2021 and 2027.
If that sounds like a lot, it's worth comparing the EU's 2021 budget to that of the United States, or Germany, or even Portugal. And now, let's make that per capita.
That's just 1 euro per person per day. The EU budget is so tiny because it doesn't include expenditure for healthcare or social security, which make up the lion's share of your usual national budget. If the run-through of headings wasn't too fast for you, you might have noticed that the EU spends a lot of its money on investments in infrastructure, research, and crisis response. Would you say we don't need those things? Still, over 60% of the EU spending goes towards two areas where the need is less obvious: cohesion and agriculture. Let's take them in turn.
The basic idea of cohesion policy is to invest money in the less developed regions in the EU, so that the red and orange spots on this map eventually become more like the yellow ones. As you can see, in practice, this mostly means channeling funds from the EU's west and north to the east and south.
What for? Well, the point of reducing inequalities is to make Europe's economies more competitive, more sustainable, and fairer. In theory, everyone benefits from that, whether they're colored red, orange, or yellow. But is it working? Well, kind of.
With the help of cohesion funding, things have really improved over the past 20 years in Eastern Europe. But they've mostly stayed the same in Southern Europe.
According to the European Commission, investments alone are not enough to help underdeveloped regions catch up. They also need better policies and management, stronger environmental protection, higher education rates, and more women in the workforce. Basically, national governments have to get more involved. But this doesn't mean that the EU's cohesion policy is pointless.
Let's not forget about the Great Recession and, of course, the COVID-19 pandemic. Had it not been for cohesion funding, the effects of these economic crises might have been much worse in the EU's poorest regions.
Conclusion: cohesion policy is a mixed bag. Now, on to agriculture. Where do we begin?
The Common Agricultural Policy, or CAP, has a 60 years long history, and its objectives make a lot of sense. But when the criticism section takes up a quarter of your Wikipedia page, you've got a problem. That said, the war in Ukraine is showing us how risky it would be to be dependent on food imports. Who knows? Without the CAP, we might not have much farming in the EU. In the current situation, agricultural subsidies are helping to prevent food shortages, extreme price increases, and maybe even a horrific famine.
There's a lot to unpack here, but we're already 9 minutes into this video and I can feel your attention slipping.
Tell you what, I will make a whole video about the CAP at some point.
For now, just know that the EU is aware of the problems and they are actively trying to fix them. Emphasis on trying.
So, is EU money spent on things member states don't need?
Depends who you ask. Now, let's talk about the final heading of the EU's long-term budget.
European Public Administration. Basically, this is the cost of running the EU institutions and paying their staff, along with schools for their children and pensions for when they retire. This brings us to question 3. Is Brussels a waste of money?
Let's start with another comparison.
In 2021, the EU institutions cost 8.2 billion euros. That's less than the cost of Germany's central administration, which was 8.5 billion euros in 2020. plus another 4 billion euros to administrate taxes and customs. And that's only the federal level. All of this is despite the fact that the EU institutions govern a much bigger, more diverse population, speaking dozens of different languages.
Putting costs aside, the EU institutions also help make cross-border cooperation more democratic, more accountable, and more efficient.
Without Brussels, European governments would probably still work together on a lot of things. The difference is that there would be no European Commission to support them, no European Parliament to control them, and no pre-agreed rules to facilitate the process. To put it another way, Brussels is why the EU works so much better than other international organizations, who often struggle to reach any agreement at all.
That's not to say that the EU institutions aren't perfect.
I've mentioned before that it doesn't make much sense for MEPs to travel to Strasbourg once a month, just because France insists, or for the council to be run by a different member state every 6 months. And there are 27 EU commissioners, not because we need all of them, but because every country wants to have one of their own at the top of the commission.
That said, Brussels is definitely not overstaffed. Despite having to rule, regulate, and represent 450 million citizens, the EU institutions only employ around 60,000 people.
Get this, more than twice as many people work for the state government of Berlin.
Let's not even bother with the number for all of Germany. And yet, the policies of the EU have an outsized impact both in Europe and beyond.
You probably know that the EU has 27 member states, but many of its laws also apply elsewhere. Let's save the details for a separate video, but the members of the European Free Trade Association have to follow many of the same rules as EU countries. Same goes for anyone who wants to join the EU or has recently left it.
In many cases, EU law actually trumps national law, although not everyone fully agrees with that. And it's not just Europe.
Ever heard of the GDPR? Brazil copied it, and so did California, Japan, Australia, South Africa, even China.
Enter the Brussels effect.
Completely voluntarily, companies all around the world follow EU rules on chemicals and competition, privacy and pollution, animal testing and air quality.
Why? Because Europe is such a big market that it just makes sense to follow its rules everywhere. Plus, companies actually trust the EU institutions to make good laws.
All of this is only possible because of Brussels. There is no Berlin or Paris or London effect.
Sorry, global Britain.
And I want you to know how sad I am.
So in terms of value for money, Brussels is hard to beat. But there could always be a better way to manage the funds, right?
So let's ask question 4. Would EU money be better spent by someone else?
First things first, the European Commission only manages 18% of the EU's budget. Almost 3/4 of the money is managed by the member states. So EU money is technically spent by someone else. But Brussels always has an eye on how EU money is used. And that's a good thing. According to the OECD, the EU budget is actually better managed and more performance-driven than any national budget in the world.
Of course, even the EU is not immune to corruption, fraud, or just plain old deception. Greenwashing is a good example. The Commission claims that 30% of the current long-term budget will help Europe fight and prepare for climate change.
That sounds great! But if the previous EU budget is anything to go by, then this number is more wishful thinking than hard fact. Instead of 20%, only 13% of the total was really climate relevant last time around. Luckily, we have the European Court of Auditors, the European Anti-Fraud Office, and the European Public Prosecutor's Office to investigate and bring the misuse of EU funds to light.
Of course, the downside of all this oversight is the added bureaucracy.
If you've ever applied for EU funding, you know that it's a chore. Then again, same goes for national funding.
Speaking of, national governments love to complain about having to send money to the EU, when really, they should be celebrating it. Let me explain. According to the World Bank, the average return on public investment is about 1.5. In other words, Every dollar spent on a public infrastructure project leads to around $1.50 of economic activity. But for every euro that national governments put into the EU budget, their countries get an average 6 euros back. That's an incredible deal. Anyone who claims that they can find a better use for EU money is not telling you the whole story.
Alright, we've covered a lot of ground and EU spending is holding up pretty well. But we haven't looked at what may be the most important aspect of all.
Namely, question 5. Are people satisfied with the EU?
To find out, let's turn to the Eurobarometer, the best source on public polling on all things EU.
First off, Europeans overwhelmingly agree that their country's membership in the EU is a good thing. If you think of national contributions as membership fees, most people would probably be happy to pay 1 euro per day to stay in the club. Europeans are also pretty convinced that the biggest global challenges are best tackled together, instead of each country going at it alone. Which makes sense when you consider that people tend to trust the EU more than their own country's national government or parliament. Although some put less trust in the EU than others. In fact, people in France, Belgium, and Luxembourg are among the most suspicious of the EU, even though that is where the EU institutions are located.
But here's the most striking result from these surveys.
Most people are generally in favor of the EU, but no less than 67% believe that it should be reformed. So although people are pretty positive about the EU, they don't think it's the best it can be quite yet.
How can it be improved, you ask? Well, the Conference on the Future of Europe just released its final report with 50 pages of ideas for exactly that. But that's a topic for another day. So what have we learned?
First, the EU can only spend money on things national governments want it spent on. Second, although it's imperfect, the EU's budget focuses on things we need and otherwise may not have. Third, the EU's institutions are relatively cheap, super efficient, and surprisingly influential. Fourth, the EU's return on investment is higher than any nation-state could dream of, bus ads or not. Fifth, people are pretty happy with the EU, but they have lots of ideas for making it even better. Let's listen up.
So now that you know how EU money is used, do you think it's a waste? Let us know in the comments below. One more thing before you go. If you're one of the many Europeans who would like to know more about their rights as an EU citizen, why don't you subscribe to Catch the Eye Politics? That's what we're here for. And I promise you, our value for money is second to none. I hope you liked this video, and if you learned something new, why don't you share it with a friend? You can find links to all the sources we used in this video, plus some bonus reading material, in the video description down below. And as always, keep your eyes open. Old regions catch up.
Catch up.
Is this an 8 or a 7? Nobody knows. Perfect. I believe.